Welcome to Insight. Today we're chatting with David Little, Director and Chief Curator of the Mead Art Museum at Amherst College. David has generously agreed to share some of his experience with us. I'd like to thank you, David, for joining us today.
Thank you.
So you are in a very interesting location. You're right in this triangle of different academic institutions, and you sit in the middle of this dialogue amongst these institutions. Talk about the actual physical location of the Mead and the universities and colleges around the Mead.
No, absolutely. We're part of the five colleges in the Pioneer Valley. And within pretty much 30 minutes, we have Hampshire College, Smith College, UMass Amherst, and then also Mount Holyoke. And we all get together at least once a month and have discussions. So there's a great dialogue and also share our collections. So it's very, very different than I really expected. When I got this job about a year ago, I didn't realize how close these museums were. I'd heard about it. But even our website, we collaborated in developing the website before I arrived. And there are other ways that we share information and talk. So
the Mead actually sits in the middle of almost a consortium. It's its own kind of microcosm of museums that then are connected to these various colleges and universities out there. So you also have the faculty, you have the art history faculty, you
exactly.
have the studio arts faculty, and then the students coming in. How does that make this experience for you as a director different?
Oh, it's phenomenal, because you are not only engaging with your own students, but you're also engaging with students at all of these colleges that come through. We have a group, for instance, called Team Mead. And Team Mead is made up of Amherst students, but it's also made up of Hampshire students as well. So there's that kind of shared knowledge, and it also is helpful if I have a project and there's a particular expertise that I don't have. I can go to the other five colleges and tap one of the professors at those colleges. So it's almost, in a funny way, you described it as a consortium. It's also closely approaches a university, but without the bureaucracy, I think, in a way. There's all of these independent small businesses that are working together.
How does it affect your exhibition schedule and how you plan? Because exhibitions, of course, have to be planned well in advance. And now you have a process in which, instead of working so much in isolation, you're actually in this intimate dialogue.
Yeah. You know, it's a matter of communicating with the other institutions, understanding what their program is. And I've spent a great deal of time looking at Smith's program and Hampshire's and Mount Holyoke. And as I begin now and look at my future there, structuring exhibitions that will establish a dialogue, but at the same time create a program that is unique,
that is independent
to Amherst, and that will attract attention, and then also really to have an identity. I think it's just so important for audiences to look at your museum and not only understand your collection, but really the vision that you have, not exhibition to exhibition, but as an overarching program.
Let's chat about the collection. Talk about the dimensions of the collection, its origins, and your collecting strategy going forward.
Well, the origins of the museum and the collection, the collection precedes the museum. The collection started really at the beginning of the 20th century with various alums giving works. And then in 1949, the museum was built. But I would say in terms of the collection itself, it has certain strengths: American art, Russian art, some Tibetan textiles, Assyrian reliefs like Bowdoin does and other museums. But I would say the two areas that I'm most excited about are really American art and Russian art. The Russian art collection was given by Thomas Whitney, a graduate who spent a lot of time in Moscow, and it includes a number of really important artists from Russia at the beginning of the century, but then also after the Stalinist era. And that is a collection of about 700 works. And we have digitized that collection, but I don't really feel as though we've introduced it to the world. So we're in the process right now of hiring a Russian curator who will do that, and will create a major catalog, and that'll be a major exhibition that will be happening. In terms of a collection strategy, that is something that's really in process right now. My first year at the Mead, I worked with the curators and we reinstalled the entire collection for the first time in 7 years. The approach in the past, which I totally understood, was to focus on masterpieces that audiences were familiar with. They would come in, teachers could teach right. for those objects. But we have 19,000 objects. And we have, you know, a relatively small museum space, about 5,000 square feet. So my idea is that I want to rotate those works quite a bit so that the students can be exposed to a full range of artwork, and really to honor those gifts and to honor their use in the collection. From a collection strategy standpoint, too, I love that process because it's one thing to look at a work on a website or to know what's in your collection as a list, but to see the kinds of conversations that can develop. So through that process, we're getting a handle on what we're going to go and do going forward. And I would say that one of the main areas that we'll really focus on is really the post-1960s era. So take the foundations of our collection, American, Russian, really strong in European, and then develop those going forward.
How do you organize the volunteer component of the museum as well as the staff component? And I'm assuming that you benefit from interns and
yeah.
those types of people. Describe for us how you look at resourcing the museum so that it has a sufficient number of people with enough expertise to help you, either on the business management side, on the on raising contributed revenue, or on just sort of opening your doors.
It's a great point. You know, in terms of the students and the volunteers, with the students, we have this group called Team Mead. We also have a number of interns that work directly with curators. I have my own intern. I love to have an intern working with the director because it allows me to connect with the students and sort of see what they're thinking. And then we have an advisory board of experts in the field that we use a great deal. And then we have special finance committee. And we now have an advancement committee, and I'm going to develop an education committee. In addition to those volunteers, I'm also trying to tap as much into experts in the field. So, for instance, with collecting and looking at the collection, I'm bringing in outside experts to evaluate our collections, to work with our curators as well.
So, of the works, I'm going to ask you a very unfair question. Of the works that you have in your collection, which work would you think is most representative of how the collection was shaped in the past, and which work is most representative of how the collection should be shaped in the future?
Yeah, the best representation of how the collection was shaped in the past is really through smart collectors, really great collectors like Whitney, who focused in on Russian art and collected in depth in that particular area, or Pratt, who collected tremendous American art.
Is there a particular work that
yeah, so Thomas Cole's Past and Present, which is one of our great masterpieces, which I think is a fantastic, wonderful painting, is one of our most popular paintings. I think that's a great example of a collector who had a real understanding of American art and then collected in that way. And in terms of new works that we're collecting, we just collected Amanda Valdez, who's a young painter, but we were able to identify a certain area that we needed to collect in, showed her work, and then collected out of that particular show.
David Little, thank you so much for sharing the experience of the Mead Art Museum at Amherst, and thank you so much for your insights.
Great. Thank you.